Welcome to Circle of Tongue. Today, the cult. And I've gone with Electric Era Cult. So don't worry, I'll be doing the Love Era in a future video because there's a lot to go through in that one. This one is more stripped down and there is actually a good story on why it was so stripped down. I'll get to that later. But first, let's get to the gear. A lot of people think it's this. The Gretsch White Falcon. Nope. It's a mid-70s Les Paul. And a Marshall, a JCM-800. But wait, it's not a JCM-800, JCM-800. It is the early four-holer. It did get modded. I'm not sure if it was modded this early on that particular album, but it did get modded at one point. So my JCM-800 is a different circuit, and it's 100 watts, so it's not going to sound exactly like it. And that's what messed me up with the old AC/DC, because they had a weird in-between model too. I believe on Let There Be Rock Era. And speaking of AC/DC, why the big jump from Love to Electric? On Love, it was all gothic. I think that's why I got a cheese wedge into Goth Broth, because a lot of goths like the cult, so I thought I'd put it in the Goth Broth, even though this is rock album. I thought I'd put it in the Goth Broth trough. Why was it so different? Electric, early on, because of the success of, you know, She Sells Sanctuary by the Seashore, because that was so big a deal. They went on to get lots of money, not physically, but to actually record the next one. And I believe it was in Richard Branson's The Manor. So this is an old, beautiful country house. Spent a lot of money on it, and they were all broke. You know, and Ian Astbury was just saying, like, he spent half of his time wandering around the grounds looking for mushrooms because they were broke, but anything to get a high, you know? So they had lots of fun. But the album was so overblown and convoluted that they had trouble actually getting a good sounding album. They thought they could save it in the mix process, so they went to the most expensive place in London to mix it, and it was still kind of sketchy. So what did they do? They went to an unknown producer. He'd never produced a full album in a full studio before. His name, Rick Rubin. They loved what he did with the Beastie Boys, because the Beastie Boys was kind of a hodgepodge put together cheap thing that they did and it became a huge hit. So fair play to this is something that doesn't go, that goes under the radar with the cult. They actually could spot talent when it came to producers early on. Even Bob Rock, when they worked with Bob Rock, he had never worked on something big producing it himself. What did they do? So they had this big overblown rock opus that wasn't getting anywhere. So when they went to New York and they went to work with Rick Rubin, Billy Duffy said the best thing was that he didn't produce the cult. He reduced the cult, stripped them back, because the cult had started to get influenced by AC/DC. When they were touring America, they started to get that little American rock. They're Australian, but they're always on the American airwaves. They started to get that bug. And it's not the first time that Rick Rubin's done this to a band. He did that to Danzig too. And that was like an AC/DC fest. You know, the oily, sleazy, basic stripped down rock and roll. And I've done Danzig in the past, if you want to check that video out after this. So they re-recorded the album in New York with a fledgling producer, and again, it was a hit. And this particular song, Little Devil, was the first band I was ever in. Actually, the first band that I ever played live in, we played this. So this is one of the tracks, one of the first riffs that I learned, and I learned it wrong. So I played it wrong all this time. So I kind of don't listen to the tracks as if it's verbatim, because I kind of wing the playing aspect of it, which I shouldn't do, but there's only so much you can do in the day. So yeah, so the setup, a weird in-between Marshall JCM-800 with the Les Paul. That was actually a Ronson-influenced move, because they removed the finish off it, like Black Les Paul, but like Ronson, they took all the finish off the front of it. I've done Ronson in the past as well. So you're in the right place, people. If you're into the classic era guitars, hit subscribe, hit like. And one little caveat for the electric album, he said that it was the Marshall, the Les Paul, and a Boost. He mentioned a Boost. Now, in the Death Cult era, he was using the OD-1, which I tried out. So that might have been floating around in his setup. But he didn't give any specifics. If you know what Boost he used, let me know. And that would be great. He's also used a Tube Screamer 808. That's been on his pedal board, so you might have used that in the past. I'm thinking about things that were around in the early 80s. Those two pedals were around, but he was very famous for loving Boss pedals, which is why I bought this flanger. I'm going to give Sanctuary a try, a 3-amp setup. So if you guys can help me out, if you know exactly what was used on Sanctuary, let me know in the comments with links to quotes and everything, not just that I think he used this, I think he used that. I believe it's a Marshall mixed in with a Roland JC120 and also a Mystery Third Amp, which I actually have a copy of. So if he only used the two, let me know. I know he used a 3-amp setup in the future. So if you have good information, search Circle of Tone in Facebook and join our Facebook group. We're over 2,000 strong, lots of gear nerds in there. And because sometimes it gets lost in the comments. I can see the first comment, but I can't see responses to the comment. So it's better to, fucking birds. Why did I put a bird feeder right outside my house? Oh, by the way, the guitar that I used, my favorite Beta guitar of all time is the Crate Electra. This is a Crate Electra. It has top of the line pickups in it. My favorite current production pickups are by a single guy called Motor City Pickups. Wade, you are the man. And, you know, it can take a while for you to get them. But when you get them, it's well, well worth the wait. Amazing, amazing pickups. Because, first of all, I tried using my Les Paul, which has 70s, late 60s, 70s era T-tops in it, but it was too low gain because I believe he used a JB in his guitar for that. So it's almost like a little boost compared to these really vintage sounding pickups. Also, a little thing, I think he used thicker strings than me, especially on the G string. I think he had a wound G string, which makes it a little bit thicker too. So little niggly details, which is why I didn't nail it, but I had a lot of fun on this one. Thanks to my patrons of Tone, Richard P. and Co. keep these speakers flapping. Major, major flappage. Sometimes I'm scared they flap so much. We have Peter. We have Daniel W. We have Foggy Brain Music. And we have Steve V. I'm trying to hit that 100 number. I think it's the highest it's ever been. So something like 77. Every time I say that, I lose like 3. But it's the highest it's been. We're getting there. Just go sign up for $1 and then cancel when I hit 100. Please. Because look, I had to change one string and there's one string flapping around. Do you like that? Do you like that fucking YouTube? Can you even see it? Can you see it? Can you fucking see it? All right, chaps. Some non-guitar related stuff coming up soon. If you like these types of vids, don't forget to like and subscribe. When you like, it tells the internet to check out my channel. What future Goth Broth episodes would you like to see? because there's a few on my radar, but it's very hard to track down some of the gear. So if you know the gear and you know the band, just let me know, because this is one of my favorite sections and I don't do it enough. All right, chaps, have a good one. You've been great. Circle of Time. Flapping, major flappage. Sometimes I'm scared they flap so much.